Good morning. Everyone is looking very lovely out there. So thanks for coming along to the session today. Super excited to have been invited to speak about a topic that I'm very passionate about, leadership, but also in the context of technology. And very excited to have some fabulous panelists on board today to go through this discussion. We've only got 20 minutes, which is great. We'll make this punchy. What I need from you all is for you to be time ninjas, okay? And what I mean by that is that if you hear any one of us speaking for more than 1 minute, right, and you're allowed to use your phones, I want you to call time ninja timeout and we'll move it on to the next person, okay? We're gonna keep it snappy, yes? Just show me your time ninja, calling it out, just make sure you hear, you get it. Some people are not. Come on, guys. Audience participation. Okay, so please just keep us on track. We want to make sure that this is an interesting, punchy conversation. So I'm going to do a super quick fire intro for my fabulous panelists here. Firstly, your name, your company, and your role. And Fiona, if we start with you.
So my name is Fiona Mullen. I lead the people team outside of the US, and I'm with Facebook.
Brilliant. Deborah. I'm Deb Lee. I'm the Chief People Officer at YOOX NET-A-PORTER, which is an e-commerce, luxury, fashion, and lifestyle organization.
Brilliant. You passed the first round. Great job. Second quick fire introduction question. Can you share with us each something you're super proud of with regards to your career to date?
I start. So this is a weird one. It was very recent, actually. I was doing an assignment in the US for a few months, and I had my two girls with me. One was 13 and the other 11 at the time. And as I was finishing my assignment, my boss wrote them a letter, which was like a report card that you get at the end of your school term on how I did for the 2 months that I was there. And they were reading to me all of my assessment, which was a bit cringy, but it was really nice to have them actually engage in the work that I do and understand exactly how what kind of impact I had when I was there, because they were obviously there with me too.
Brilliant. Nice. Deborah?
I think probably for me, the proudest achievement in my career so far is some of the work, the legacy work that I did with BT around youth and unemployment and also tech skills. So we did a big program around tech literacy, and also we were part of an organization called Movement to Work, which was about the sort of people who weren't in employment, who can't get in employment, the NEETs of the UK. And both of those things started as sort of small embryonic ideas and built through just the passion of some of the folk in the organisation. We had no budget and no resources, but just kind of a lot of lobbying of leaders and other organisations. And now it's affected millions of children in terms of some of the participation in the Barefoot campaign, and also tens of thousands of children in terms of the tech literacy piece, because it's a social inclusion, data encoding is something that people need to do. So I think those are the sorts of things, and I still feel immense pride of the team that are far more talented than I ever was, that continue and do much better without me there. And I think those are the sorts of things, is not necessarily the things that you do personally, but the things that you start that have a life after you've left and affect people's lives. So for me, that would be that.
Brilliant. Great stories, both of you. Right, the next quickfire round question, which is one I'm actually very interested to hear the response to. What's the worst job you've ever had? Can't all be glossy Facebook, NET-A-PORTER. There's got to be something in there that's been a little less glamorous.
This was an easy one for me. It was a college job. I did my master's down the road here at LSE, and as part of my bursary, I had to stack books 2 afternoons a week. Often I would be a little hungover, it has to be said, but that was definitely my most boring, because the minutes literally took more than you could imagine. So, but since then, I have to say, there hasn't
been a boring job. It's only been an upside since then, yeah.
Slight uptick in my career since then.
Brilliant. Thank you. Deb?
I found this quite hard, because I quite like doing even crappy things. And when I was at university, I did some modelling, and there were some very dodgy, cold, freezing assignments. But actually, I think probably the most frustrating one was when I was post-university, I had a stint in telesales, mm-hmm. which is number one, repetitive, number two, soul-destroying, and number three, you know you're the most irritating person that that person's spoken to that day. So I think that that also kind of made me think, I definitely don't want to be in telesales.
I hope no one... Here
I don't think anyone grows up saying, I really want to be a call centre agent. And so when I came into the BT role and I had call centres, I started with a view of, I know how horrible this can be, yeah. so how do we make it more fun? Because it can be soul-destroying, just speaking to people and they're hanging up on you, or some of them really very rude.
Yeah. So we have had less glamorous jobs. I always win this competition, by the way. When you talk about crappy jobs, I literally had a crappy job, which involved picking up dog shit. I'm not sure if I'm allowed to say that on stage. That I had a job in college where I was actually picking up dog shit in a kennels. So I always win that, who got the worst job.
Sure.
Anyway, last quick fire intro round, and then I'm going to ask, and we're going to find out who's in the audience a little bit. What's the favourite thing you do in your current role? What's a favourite part of your current role? So Fiona, you first.
For me... Our company is growing at a very fast rate, and it is all about building new things and knowing when the right time is to build those new things, because we literally cannot build all of the infrastructure around how we want to run things at the same time. And so as we go through kind of each cycle of growth, there's a kind of a new challenge. And so there really hasn't been, in the 4 years that I've been with Facebook, a kind of same year. So it's this constant, some of these things that present themselves as real problems that we need to solve. But honestly, it's this sense of building and growth and kind of building on top of the foundation that we've been building the previous year.
Yeah.
So that would be mine.
Very exciting. Yeah, and for you, Deb?
Mine's actually quite similar because we're post-merger and I've been in with the organisation for just over a year. And actually, two organisations without a HR infrastructure, building everything from scratch. And by everything, I mean everything. The systems, processes, policies, cultural architecture, and the team. And I think one of the things that I feel happiest about is I've been able to really handpick my top team, and they're awesome. And I'm not saying that because a couple of them are sitting facing me, but, you know, they are. But I think when you get the opportunity to start from scratch and a blank sheet of paper, you can step back and say, there is no legacy to stop us, but actually what is the future of leadership? What do we stand for? How do we ensure that we architect the right outcomes as a business? And how do we remain really passionate about the product and the customer? So I think those are the things that I'm quite excited about at the moment.
Brilliant.
I was just going to add on, clearly Facebook has been in the news a little bit over the last couple of days, which is really important. And these issues we take extremely seriously. So all of our company is very engaged at the moment in trying to understand exactly what's happened and how we solve for that. It's not something I'm going to be able to speak about today, but I do want you to know that I want to acknowledge that all of you, I'm sure, are thinking, you know, is she going to talk a little bit about what's happening at Facebook? But just to rest assured, you know, these are serious issues from our perspective, and we're really, really focused on working on them.
Brilliant. Thanks for calling that out, Fiona. So now we know a little bit more about you guys. Super quick fire round. I'd love to just get a bit more of a sense of who's in the audience. So just by a show of hands, first question, an easy one. Who's at the Unleash conference right now? Okay. Very good, right? Who's had more than two coffees already today? Most of us, right? Okay, we're all together, we're with our people, which is great. Who would say their main focus of their role is HR, kind of predominant HR focus in your role? And who would say technology would be the predominant focus? Bit of a mix, okay. Who would say something else that's not tech or HR related? One, okay, welcome, wherever you're from. Right, okay, so that gives us a little bit of a sense of who we've got here. Now we're going to get into the juicy stuff, into the content, and really kind of uncover and kind of get some lessons learned from these experts on leadership in the digital age. So what I wanted to start with, actually, for both of you, is just to tell us a little bit around what your philosophy and your thinking is around the role of technology in terms of leadership. And Deb, do you want to start with this one?
Well, I think, I mean, for leaders, there's a new challenge with technology. It gives you a lot of insight, it gives you a lot of data, it gives you a lot of power, actually. And I think from a leadership point of view, and I'm very conscious I have Facebook sitting next to me, you know, I think there's some ethical questions that that leaders need to ask around how do we use the data in what way, and also how do we use it in a way that's morally right. Mm-hmm. So I think from a leadership point of view, it's a scanning the vast array of information that you have in front of you and sifting through what is important and what matters without losing yourself, because you can sometimes see that people use stats or think they know how to use it, or they use profiling, or they use whatever it is to get the argument that they want across. But fundamentally, you need that kind of core, stable line that says this is what we stand for as a company and this is what matters. So I think it's a great tool, but it's not the answer to everything. Because you've got to have a understanding of why you're in the business and what you're trying to do.
Yeah. Okay. Great. And Fiona, from your perspective,
really important points. I think where I'd add on to the great points that Deb has made is in the area of, I guess, communication and transparency. Because when I think about how we use technology, obviously we use Facebook in Facebook. We have a lovely product called Workplace, which I'll give my team a plug downstairs. We have a stall whereby, you know, everybody's engaged using an internal social media platform. And so information travels really quickly. And there is an immediate engagement from our employees to everybody else, whether it's an executive or a manager, on topics that they care about and also around the work that they're doing. So how decisions get made, how work gets done is really no longer mapped purely to the organizational hierarchy of a company, but it's around the core, you know, value of that work and how it needs to be orchestrated. And that's viral, it's messy, it's kind of, you know, it's up and down, it's left to right. But it means, therefore, that it kind of the demand to move very quickly, to move at speed, and to be super transparent. It really pushes us to be to kind of answer the challenge that technology brings because of that level of transparency and engagement that you get with technology.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I would just like to say, we've just implemented Workplace into our business and we're finding it fantastic. And actually one of the things that was really quite powerful from a leadership point of view was to say to the leaders, the best thing we can do is let this go. Because you can't control or manage the content. You've got to make it available for employees and the social team will create their own norms. And one of our most popular pages is Pet-A-Porter. People post pictures of their pets and they talk about what they do, which is, you know, some people say, what's that got to do with work? But actually it's saying that people can bring their authentic self to work and be passionate about what they want and create connections with other people. And so, and that's scary for the traditional leader who's like, what? Bring your personality to work? Don't you just do what I tell you? So I think there is a real challenge in the role of the leader as a facilitator with the aids of such brilliant tools like Workplace, which I think, you know, requires letting go a little bit.
Absolutely. So having the openness and the trust and the transparency and then seeing what happens and creating the platform where kind of those spontaneous conversations and breaking down of the silos
it really demands for us to stand back a little bit, the HR function, which typically can be seen as very much a controlling of culture, controlling decision making and policy. And so that's an uncomfortable position for some to be in as well, but it's worth doing.
Worth doing, absolutely. Brilliant, thank you both for that. So moving on to the topic of inclusion and potentially diversity. Fiona, for you, what does this mean? What does it mean to you personally? But also, as a leader, how can we all do a better job with bringing this to life and truly being inclusive and diversity, focused on diversity in the work that we do?
Look, I think, like most of you, I'm sure, we're very passionate about this subject. And I, for one, have been in the HR game a bit too long and have been, you know, have come from the world where we did all of the politically correct things and all of the kind of latest standards of what you do with diversity. I'm glad to say that I think we've come a long way. And it's been refreshing working for a young company that has come in perhaps at this late in the game. So for me, it's very much about authentic self and bringing yourself to work. And again, I guess the point that I would make in terms of our experience is when you come into Facebook, you're using your Facebook profile at work, and so people see who you are at home, and so you're supposed to walk in the physical doors of the office and be the same person as you were over the weekend. Yeah. And I think that what that does is invite people to be who they really are, irrespective of their kind of, you know, background and makeup. Obviously there are things that we need to do for specific groups to work harder to enable them feel included, but it kind of comes right down to kind of a manager and employee level, and an employee to employee relationship is what can I do to enable somebody feel included? How do I acknowledge that I have bias, and so I understand how that plays out in my relationships and how I build teams? And once you start there, you just unleash this cognitive diversity that for us is really, really important aspect of how we innovate and how we solve problems. So for me, that's ultimately how I think about it. Yeah.
One of the things that we did internally at Google was work out what are the attributes of high-performing teams. And some of you may have seen this research, but I think the interesting thing we found out is actually creating an environment of psychological safety was the single most influential factor for high-performing teams. And I think it's really about the inclusivity, diversity, and bringing your authentic self to work. So very aligned with that. Deborah, on to you. Something I wanted to check in with you about is kind of this idea of risk-taking and of people being, as leaders, being able to demonstrate that they can fail and creating an environment where that is acceptable. Tell me what's your thoughts on that?
Well, I think there's two things. I think firstly, your point about psychological safety is very important because it has a huge impact on how risk-averse or risk-taking organisations are. I'm currently working for fast-moving entrepreneurial founder-led organizations where experimentation has been part of the DNA of the organization. And yet sometimes you observe some slight risk aversion. I mean, it's naturally inherent in human beings to take the least personal risk path. Whether it's a big organization or a small organization, it's all about the social norm. And there was a piece of research done in the US around the contagiousness of risk-taking. So depending on the behaviours of the team and what they see their peers doing and how they observe other people making risks would depend very much on their attitude to risk. Yeah. So it's a very big cultural issue and it can be architected. So I think that there's a piece around saying it's okay to fail, right? You know, because the biggest moves in any technology or organization or thinking is that discontinuous thinking, the thought that no one else has thought before. So it should be okay to have that thought. And there's a difference between making a mistake once and making it over and over again, which just suggests you don't learn. So you want to create a learning environment which celebrates that for every 10 experiments, you know, maybe some of them won't come off, as long as they're not illegal or they're morally issues, you know, actually we should encourage it. It's the learning that matters. And so I think the company's attitude to how you take a mistake and learn from it and apply that going forward actually is a demonstration of how successfully you'll be in the future.
Yeah, brilliant, excellent. Now I'm conscious of time and I want to ask my sort of wrapping up question, which for both of you is just, if we're thinking about the attributes and qualities that leaders in a digital age need and the things that we should all be inspired to embody, I guess, what are the three attributes, and a question for each of you, what are the three attributes you think are most required for this new age of leadership? Fiona, do you want to...
So I think the concept of leaders building followership is really core to, I guess, what you have described as leadership in the digital age, but the future of leadership. And I think all of us, you know, who are in companies that are looking for high-performing talent, that's definitely what they're coming to see. And at the core of that is what I've talked about already around transparency, people being able to access you know, all the information that they need and be given kind of full disclosure. I think the second thing is a learning mindset and, you know, again, breaking down this more traditional view of leaders as we have in our HR profession, looked across a whole range of competencies and trying to build very effective leaders. I think we need to acknowledge that that's kind of an impossible task and we need to be looking for more enlightened leaders and those that have a learning mindset and who are learning constantly from the people around them and drawing from the most diverse set of inputs. And then I think the last thing is actually a humility. Mm-hmm. And it's the kind of confidence and humility to invite people in and understand when, you know, mistakes are made and what we learn from them and keep that very, very core to the culture of an organization.
Yeah, so followership, transparency, learning and humility.
Sorry, I didn't keep to three.
That's all right.
I agree on humility. I won't expand on that one. I think adaptability.
Yeah.
With adaptability comes resilience, because the two things go hand in hand. And finally, I think it's really about this, about communication. Mm-hmm. So, and communication is two ways. So it's the ability to listen. Mm-hmm. There's just too much you can't know. So coaching comes from being able to communicate and be able to listen. So I think that they're all the sort of building blocks.
Okay. Humility, adaptability, comms, and coaching.
We're in HR, not finance, so we like to break the rules, yes. Not stick to three.
Yes, absolutely. Brilliant. Well, thank you, ladies, so much for sharing your insights. I hope you all found that interesting, and please give them a big round of applause.